The Benson Murder Case, a Philo Vance story by S.S. Van Dyne, narrated by John Rayburn. Publisher's note, it gives us considerable pleasure to be able to offer to the public the inside record of those of former District Attorney Markham's criminal cases in which Mr. Philo Vance figured so effectively. The true inwardness of these famous cases has never before been revealed, for S.S. Van Dyne, Mr. Vance's lawyer and almost constant companion, being the only person who possessed a complete record of the facts, has only recently been permitted to make them public. After inspecting Mr. Van Dyne's voluminous notes, we decided to publish The Benson Murder Case as the first of the series, not because it was the most interesting and startling, nor yet the most complicated and dramatic from the fictional point of view, but because, coming first chronologically, it explains how Mr. Philo Vance happened to become involved in criminal matters, and also because it possesses certain features that reveal very clearly Mr. Vance's unique analytic methods of crime detection. If you will refer to the municipal statistics of the city of New York, you will find that the number of unsolved major crimes during the 4 years that John F.X. Markham was district attorney was far smaller than under any of his predecessors' administrations. Markham projected the district attorney's office into all manner of criminal investigations, and as a result, many abstruse crimes on which the police had hopelessly gone aground were eventually disposed of. But although he was personally credited with the many important indictments and subsequent convictions that he secured, the truth is that he was only an instrument in many of his most famous cases. The man who actually solved them and supplied the evidence for their prosecution was in no way connected with the city's administration and never once came into the public eye. At that time, I happened to be both legal advisor and personal friend of this other man, and it was thus that the strange and amazing facts of the situation became known to me. But not until recently have I been at liberty to make them public. Even now, I am not permitted to divulge the man's name, and for that reason, I have chosen arbitrarily to refer to him throughout these ex officio reports as Philo Vance. It is, of course, possible that some of his acquaintances may, through my revelations, be able to guess his identity, and if such should prove the case, I beg of them to guard that knowledge, for though he has now gone to Italy to live and has given me permission to record the exploits of which he was the unique central character, he has very emphatically imposed his anonymity upon me, and I should not like to feel that through any lack of discretion or delicacy, I have been the cause of his secret becoming generally known. The present chronicle has to do with Vance's solution of the notorious Benson murder, which, due to the unexpectedness of the crime, the prominence of the persons involved, and the startling evidence adduced, was invested with an interest rarely surpassed in the annals of New York's criminal history. This sensational case was the first of many in which Vance figured as a kind of impartial advisor in Markham's investigations, told by author S.S. Van Dyne as though Vance is a real person. Chapter 1, Philo Vance at Home, Friday, June 14, 8:30 a.m. It happened that, on the morning of the momentous June the 14th, when the discovery of the murdered body of Alvin H. Benson created a sensation which, to this day, has not entirely died away, I had breakfasted with Philo Vance in his apartment. It was not unusual for me to share Vance's luncheons and dinners, but to have breakfast with him was something of an occasion. He was a late riser, and it was his habit to remain incommunicado until his midday meal. The reason for this early meeting was a matter of business, or rather of aesthetics. On the afternoon of the previous day, Vance had attended a preview of Vollard's collection of Cezanne watercolors at the Kessler Galleries, and having seen several pictures he particularly wanted, he had invited me to an early breakfast to give me instructions regarding their purchase. A word concerning my relationship with Vance is necessary to clarify my role of narrator in this chronicle. The legal tradition is deeply embedded in my family, and when my preparatory school days were over, I was sent, almost as a matter of course, to Harvard to study law. It was there I met Vance, a reserved, cynical, and caustic freshman who was the bane of his professors and the fear of his fellow classmen. Why he should have chosen me of all the students at the university for his extra-scholastic association, I have never been able to understand fully. My own liking for Vance was simply explained. He fascinated and interested me, and supplied me with a novel kind of intellectual diversion. In his liking for me, however, no such basis of appeal was present. I was, and am now, a commonplace fellow possessed of a conservative and rather conventional mind. But at least my mentality was not rigid, and the ponderosity of the legal procedure did not impress me greatly, which is why, no doubt, I had little taste for my inherited profession. And it is possible that these traits found certain affinities in Vance's unconscious mind. There is, to be sure, the less consoling explanation that I appealed to Vance as a kind of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.